to the music, your enthusiasm for the Round Top Music Festival and being an aspiring young oboe player with the world in front of you. Strauss at the time is in a very different place in his life than you are right now. So we're all actors, and we need to sort of assume that character. Okay, so when was this written? If you look at the copyright, 1947, not so long after the war ended, not so far away from when he is going to unfortunately pass away. So this is the tail end of his life. And I don't think it's necessarily perhaps autobiographical, but I do think that in many ways it's reflective of his experience. He knows that he's had a rich and full life. He knows that it is converging on completion. And I think this poignancy, the reflection of his life experience, maybe it could be a synopsis, not an autobiography, a synopsis of his life. So at the time, he is tired. He is a little quite melancholy. He's not necessarily enthusiastic about what's to come. It's a peaceful time in his life, but also a little tired. And we don't want you to be tired playing this as well. So I think if you could just get a little used to it. So even the first entrance, so I heard a little bit of
reflection.
lovely. I thought it was really beautiful. I love the way you built to this. You know, we finally think, oh, he's actually getting up out of his rocking chair and, you know, going to be a little bit more exuberant. But then it's almost like, oh, he's a little tired still. He's going to sit back down. You could even, I think, be more espresso and take a little bit more time. psychology. So we have Gregorian chant, and that leads to incredibly complicated mashal with pockets and all this really big stuff. And then, we have to simplify. So you go back to the Oxford, codex, so they're very, very strict homophony. Then the end of the Renaissance, unbelievable florid, right? So then we get back to simplicity. And then we're at the beginning of the Baroque, which is quite simple. Then that goes through Bach. We have to do it again. Go back to ostinato, bass line, and simple melody. And this is going to continue. We get to the end of Mahler. We're going to have these symphonies that go on for an hour and a half. What follows that? Second Viennese school. This cycle goes over and over and over. So how do you see, or how do you hear Bach stretching the limits of the Baroque sonata in this piece? In what way is it different than playing a Handel sonata, a Telemann sonata, or Vivaldi?
Yeah, I think the ornamentation for sure. There's like a lot of just written in, and then the repetition, and then like where it just changes color completely. But yeah, I'd say mainly I think the ornamentation.
Yeah, the ornamentation, yeah, for sure. I mean, I would say the first thing that comes to mind is the extreme length of it. You know, you compare the sonata to a Handel sonata, it's about four times as long.
Yeah.
And second, I would say exactly what you said, that Bach begins writing in all of his own ornamentation. So that's why we're very, very Spartan with whatever ornaments we might want to have. So what I hear from you right now is a little bit too much of a, almost too much importance, too much of a muscular quality, to the ornaments, because they look on the page like they're the same as all the other notes.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, obviously there's more beams on them, and there's more notes per beat, but it's impossible to write out ornaments. That's why we typically use symbols instead, because the symbols, you know, they become filigree. And I think you're sort of, in your effort to be really rhythmic, which is great and admirable, sort of giving a little bit too much focus. So let's just go back to the very beginning, the first couple of bars, and let's see what the important notes are, because they're not going to be the little ornaments, right? So basically, we have a pickup to tonic.
Okay.
Lift. So, have you ever tried to play the Baroque oboe before?
Yes.
Yeah.
In your office.
Yes, there you go. Right. What did you notice about the Baroque oboe?
You could feel all the vibrations. It was amazing.
Yeah, you're connected with the wood. You're not playing keys. You're actually lifting and sort of covering the holes. You're one with the instrument to really feel. And I think that's really important.
Okay.
So even these moving notes, you sort of have this sense of that you're lifting, opening holes instead of lifting a key. What else did you notice about the Baroque oboe?
The embouchure felt different, like jumping from in different octaves. I felt like the voicing had to be a lot more drastic than.
Yeah, you really had to lift. You have to lift to those high notes.
Yeah.
How did the size of the reed affect your articulation?
It felt more buoyant than pecky, I feel.
Yes, exactly. I think you're. Not that this cannot be effective on a Baroque as well. I think we can learn a lot from listening to a Baroque oboe, because obviously that would be the sound that he has in his mind. So I do think you could extend, it's a little short here.
Okay.
I hear.
Okay.
One, two, two, three, three. So that actually actually sweeping us forward and taking us someplace. Okay, now, of course, we would think that the high C would be the most important one, right?
Yeah, I'm starting in C flat.
Okay.
Thank you.
something like this, too, and it is minor.
Yeah.
And it is, there is, I think, a lovely pull mm-hmm. in every one of these measures. And that pull, and you get too, I won't say it's flippant, but it's a little too lighthearted, and it's just at odds.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so your next entrance. Okay, so actually, you have a little cadence, if we can say this is a cadence.
Okay.
breathe in on the first rest, breathe out on the second. Breathe in, breathe out.
Metamorphosis, which is his big work, is talking a lot about and this movement specifically, Niobe, is about Niobe, who, she made a blasphemous kind of statement against the gods, and so they killed all her children, and she turned into stone, which is pretty dark. But all of these movements deal with some sort of change in some way. Niobe being her turning into stone, which relates to this mountain in Greece where there was the porous limestone, water seeps through it, so they see it crying. So that's kind of a myth to explain that.
Yeah, wonderful. Great. So I feel that, well, first of all, everything you said is spot on.
Great.
I think that it's really important when you're playing this to know in each of the six, because there's six metamorphoses, it's really important to know a few things. One, where you feel the metamorphosis happens. So where do you feel that she turns into stone?
I was seeing it after the Fermata end, where it's like the little recap, the whole thing statement.
That's what I need to do now, for sure. Okay, also, I think it's important to know why the metamorphosis happened. You did sort of touch on this with the synopsis of Niobe made a blasphemous statement against the god. I think all six of them do have a character, a pretty major character flaw that gets them into a lot of trouble, and which is bound to be examples for humanity for, you know, in perpetuity as examples of what not to do. Yes. Okay, so what do you think he doesn't give us any information. Lamenting the death of her 14 children was turned into a mountain. So you think, oh, she's a victim. And it is really terrible that 14 children were killed. But why do you think, what do you think her character flaw might be?
Well, she's definitely very arrogant, very full of herself. She, when her, the, specifically the blasphemous claim she made is that she was saying, well, you know, I have all these children, and this god only has two, so I'm, you know, why aren't you worshiping me?
Exactly.
So, yeah.
Yes. So she's boastful.
Yeah.
We had an arrogant boy in Faking, too, but this is a different type of arrogance, I would say. She's more boastful, and I think also she was very beautiful, and her statement had something to do with the goddess, who was also beautiful, but Niobe said something, well, I'm just as beautiful as you are, and I have 14 children, and you only have two. So then, yeah, she, in retaliation, her children were killed. So, I mean, that's a brutal punishment,
yeah.
Obviously. But, okay, so we know why the metamorphosis, we know where. And, you know, this is all subjective, obviously. Every interpretation that Britain didn't give us a roadmap. And he didn't want to give us a roadmap. This means this and this means that. Okay, now, I think the most important part of playing all six of these is to know, for you to recognize how Britain brings out this character flaw, or compositionally, how does he make the story unfold? So what do you see that he's doing in this, in Niobe, that sort of tells this story?
Well, definitely some of the harmonic stuff is very, yeah, very tense harmonically. A lot of half steps, a lot of kind of, you know, moving out of the key in very interesting ways. I think a lot of these like big jumps up to the B flat kind of.
Chaos.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely this forte section in the middle is, because most of it's pretty introspective, but I guess, you know, really puts it out there.
Yeah, I mean, almost hysteria.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Because, I mean, she's lamenting the death of her children to such a degree that they are like, okay, let's either put her out of her misery or, you know, let's contain this a little bit so
right.
That we turn her to stone.
But
so she can't feel.
I do feel like this one all happens after the death of her children, so it doesn't actually depict what she did necessarily in the same way that some of the other ones did.
Great. I 100% agree. So he writes, mezzo forte piangendo at the beginning, and what's piangendo mean? Weeping. Okay, so what do you see in the very first measure that denotes weeping?
Downward slurs.
Stop it. avoid that.
So Bacchus, This is the subtitle for Britain is, "At whose feast is heard the noise of gaggling women's tattling tongues and shouting out of boys."
Who's Bacchus?
Bacchus is another name, the name of the Romans used for the Greek god Dionysus, who was the god of, you know, revelry and chaos, kind of,
and wine
and theater. For some reason, theater comes to it, but I think
he's most well known as being a god of wine.
Wine is the most well known, but
he's the god of wine.
But he fits a really interesting place in here because the rest of them are, where most of these are mortals being affected by the gods, whereas Bacchus is the god himself. And when I was reading through kind of the synopsis of what Ovid wrote, there are like a lot of stories involving metamorphoses that he's somewhat involved in some way.
Interesting. What do you feel his metamorphosis might be?
He's one of those gods that in the mythology that Ovid writes about, he's one that's like constantly interfering with people's lives on Earth. So it seems like, he's kind of a little trickster. Sometimes in a less, you know, a very harmful way, getting people killed in his little pranks. But I feel like, he'll like take the form of different things to go around and mess with people.
I still keep coming back to the god of wine. I personally...
There's some drunk elements, certainly, I think.
I think the metamorphosis here is not him changing into something else, or necessarily anyone changing into anything else. I think it is Bacchus going from sobriety to drunkenness. And the one thing that we do know, in Britain was extremely careful to not... He didn't want... hyper-analysis of his music in that this note means this, and now this is happening, so we have to be careful that we don't do that. But he did himself say that these were hiccups. So we know that he's a little bit tipsy at the end. Okay. Alright, so let's go to the beginning. This opening theme. So, what part of the story that he's laid out that we have Bacchus himself, we have gaggling women, we have shouting out a voice? What is this theme?
General subject of Britain's thing is that feasts. I guess this is kind of the atmosphere at the start before things have gotten crazy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And, this theme is obviously going to come back many times. So I think that each time you play it, the party may be in a different stage. All right. So allegro pesante. What's pesante?
Heavy.
So. How does that word fall into the depiction of a party? Doesn't make sense at first, does it?
Yeah.
Have you seen many pictures of Bacchus?
I haven't.
He's pesante. So I think you could have more a sense of even the themes are rolling. I mean, he's a big. And he's gregarious. He's a little interfering, meddling. I think that's really great. I think people in general really loved it when Bacchus showed up to the party because he was the god of wine and he was a good person to have at that party. However, he also sort of wore out his welcome pretty quickly. So there is a little sense of irritation, even, I think, early on. But yeah, so try to get this sense of pesante and get a sense of sort of this rolling gregariousness of his personality and of the party. your bucket theme?
Definitely lighter, kind of, you know, I think it's very light at his feet here, in general. Maybe it's a little bit annoying in some ways. I think the one later on, I think is just more just fun. This one is, there's an element of kind of being a little bit grating, even though it's not the same kind of, not the same way as the boy.
I think he gets that with slurring, not the beats. So that, you know, Buck is just saying, ba-da-da-da-da-da-da, you know, it's very strict, no question, nothing syncopated, it's just, you know, just very straightforward. This one, I think you could bring out the and, you know, the...
Obviously, we don't want to.